Ladies and gentlemen, it's really a privilege and honor to moderate such distinguished panel, and I would like to invite to the podium our wonderful speakers, and wow, that sounds even better. I would like to invite Prime Minister Ivana Klempush-Tsinadze from Ukraine, Madam. I would like to invite President Thomas Ilves. He's on the way. Okay, good, good. I would like to invite President Vaira Vike Freiberga. And I would like to invite General James Jones, or like General Breedlove asked me to call him Mr. Breedlove, so Mr. Jones, pleasure to have you, sir, with us. You will be always general, believe me. We have former Marine Corps team members, so it's like this. I don't have to really introduce our wonderful guests and speakers, because you all know them. But just to remind the highlights of your current career, Prime Minister of Ukraine Ivana Klempush-Tsinadze is responsible for European integration. I will be always underlying it because I think it matters. And you're Atlantic as well. I think it matters, and I believe that this is the right person in the right place. To not only in Warsaw, but also in Kyiv. I'm really honored that we have today with us President Vaira Vike Freiberga, not only because she was President of the Republic of Latvia in 1999-2007, but also because she's recipient of the Knight of Freedom, or actually Madame of Freedom, award that our foundation was privileged to grant you a couple of years ago. And I'm really delighted that we have today with us General James Jones, not only National Security Advisor to the President Obama, but also Supreme Allied Commander, and also, as I was ordered to underline, the former Commander of Marine Corps in the United States. We have right now somewhere in the air a question about the future of the world we know. The world I know, it's a peaceful Europe. It's a region without war. When I look west, it's a region with a war. When I look east, people, so-called millennials in Europe, they think that everything is given for granted. When I speak with my grandparents, they don't think that it was given for them for granted. And I have an impression, and I believe that this is not only my view, that many of contemporary stakeholders, leaders in many capitals of Euro-Atlantic community deserve a shot of espresso to wake up from stagnation, which serves not us, but all our enemy, internal and external. And unfortunately, if we take a look on the map of the crises we experience both in Europe and in US, starting from Ukraine crisis, migrant crisis, cyber challenges, and rise of illiberalism in our communities. So my question to our distinguished speakers is the liberal order indeed under threat? And do we have the determination and the will to preserve it? And maybe I will start with Madam President, if you don't mind. From your experience, are you concerned?
Yes, I think I would join Dan Fried in warning us that there's definitely a movement afoot to deny what we consider have been great achievements in liberalizing attitudes and values. And I think it might help if we start by defining our terms a little. And I think liberalism can be defined in many ways, but one of them that is important is that it allows the potentiality and the possibility of differences of opinion coexisting side by side without violence and confrontation, but without any one particular view being imposed on others in an absolutist, authoritarian, and violent way. And we do have these extremes today in movements like Daesh, ISIL, if you like, where religious extremism is taken for as an excuse, basically, for violence and destruction and imposing one's own version of whatever one imagines. But there are places where violence is committed either for gain or for its own sake. And I spent 6 years representing European, the eastern part of Europe, at the International Criminal Court in Hague on the board of the Trust Fund for Victims. And we looked at the victims in places in Africa where there had been recognized, internationally recognized crimes against humanity, war crimes, genocide. And what we find there frequently is that violence is committed for its own sake. Le Marquis de Sade, in fact, is one intellectual, if you like, intellectually refined example of that sort of philosophy. But that is not a liberal philosophy. Whereas the totalitarians, if you like, or the absolutists of today, are reproaching liberalism for not having any values. You see, and when we talk about liberal values, those who are against them will say, well, liberalism means there is no values. And we therefore, I mean, Mr. Putin being such a great philosopher, of course, is representing what he considers a certain philosophy and certain values, and claims that the West does not have any. And what the West does have is a moral compass. And I think it's very grave. We have to recognize that the liberality of the West means tolerance. It means accepting plurality of views up to a point. But it doesn't mean the loss of a moral compass. It doesn't mean the loss of sexual identity, as some, for instance, in Russia are claiming, including Mr. Putin. Nor does it really, and this sometimes among Europeans is not very clear, it does not mean taking away your identity, regional, ethnic, or national. I think there's a misapprehension about what nationalism means, and people are being reproached for being nationalist when they really worried about their roots and their identity. And we haven't been able to make the difference between absolutism and violence and the fact of looking for your roots and your identity. We are not alike. We are not like peas in a pod. Human beings are different from each other, but they do seek an identity of some sort. Liberalism does not mean lack of moral compass. It does not mean lack of values, but it does mean a slow evolution and an accumulation, which has taken centuries and lots of blood to achieve, which I think Western civilization has established. And that is what is being denied and is being threatened by many. And I think it's something that is just as much important to defend today as it was in the Middle Ages or at any other time.
Thank you, Madam President, for this very deep answer. General, you're representing contemporary Rome. Is a liberal order a threat? And I'm not asking about the result of the elections. Not yet. Because you are representing the liberal order and the point, you are the point of reference for those nations that are aspiring to democracy. But you are also the bad one that is used consciously and regularly, particularly by leaders in Kremlin, to undermine the credibility of democracy and liberal order. Is it a threat?
Well, I think this is a very good question, because I do think the liberal order, as we're defining it, is definitely under threat. And the question is, I think fundamentally, is do we have the will to lead it and preserve it? I've had the benefit in my life of being raised in Europe and during the Cold War, and returned to the United States for my professional life in the military and in government. So I think I have a pretty good idea on the cultural differences. When you use words like liberalism in the United States, it's liberal versus conservative, and it means something completely different. But I think that what we've established since 1945 is a series of anchor points that are based on common values and beliefs. And there are times that you have to defend those values and those beliefs with demonstrated action, that people who are opposing your fundamental values and beliefs do not misunderstand. And I don't mean necessarily the use of military force to solve every problem. And as a matter of fact, I think one of the big differences between the 20th and the 21st century is that the security concepts that we value are much broader today than they were in the 20th century, when in fact the military coefficient was the primary button that people either pushed or threatened to push. I don't think that's the case anymore. I think the security challenges that our liberal order is facing come from not only state actors, but non-state actors. It's very asymmetric. And we have had a difficult time, I think, coalescing into fashioning a proper response to those threats. And I think in my country, there's a raging debate right now about what the United States will do or not do as a key player in the defense of the liberal order. My personal belief is that after talking about it in many different ways and trying different things, we will do the right thing, but it takes a while to get there. This is a difficult time. I think we are under threats. I think the 21st century, because of the scope and the variety of threats, is causing our institutions that were built for a different world to have a difficult time to respond as rapidly as these threats face us. But we have to have that agility. We have to have that commitment. And we have to have that leadership. And I certainly am one who hopes very clearly that the United States, after the elections, will regain that understanding of why the United States has to play its role in conjunction with our friends and allies.
Thank you, General. Prime Minister Klimpustinadze, you are representing the country that is experiencing war at its own territory. Unless we will include Latvia with its cyber attacks permanently happening from Russian directions, but you are experiencing a real war at your territory. Poland was called by famous British historian God's playground. Isn't it happening right now with Ukraine? That on one side we have green men and Russia, on another side we have West that is hesitantly helping you to defend your territorial integrity. You are representing the country that is an example that it is possible to undermine the borders in Europe in the post-World War order. What is your perspective on the state of liberal order that European Union and transatlantic community is representing? Are we healthy?
Well, first of all, thank you for giving me the chance to be in such a distinguished company here, and I'm absolutely humbled to be speaking with such important and great figures on this panel. I would just want to start with echoing what was already said in terms of that we are living in a very challenging times, and I'm sure that already everybody is kind of accepting the fact that we are also living in the time which is full of unpredictability. And what was said also on the previous panel when Minister Linkevičius, he was talking about reacting. Are we fast enough to react? The problem is that the liberal order is the way it is created, the way the critical thinking, questioning of this or that type of point of view, this variety of opinions that is very useful and has been very useful for the development of liberal order is not thinking in the same terms as the authoritarian regimes do. For Russia, as we see it, it seems that they do not know any other thinking besides the zero-sum thinking. And they have not come up from that paradigm. And therefore, that they are punch drunk with the with their success of the illegal annexation of Crimea, and that weakness that some of the EU leaders have shown in initial reaction to the annexation of Crimea. I really sincerely believe that those sanctions that the EU and the US to that point and other partners have imposed on Russia immediately after annexation of Crimea, they were, to put it mild, pitiful. They were not necessarily really a reaction to a blatant violation, cynical violation of the international law, of the international order that was so already taken for given, for granted, in Europe during the whole post-World War II period of time. So do we think that the reaction we are seeing from the world is adequate? If it was adequate, then it would not require so many efforts from each and every one of those partners who understand very well what it means to be occupied by the Russian Federation. It would not expect from President Ilves, from President Vika Freiberga, from our Lithuanian friends and colleagues, from Polish friends and colleagues, from American friends and colleagues, to make so many efforts in order to get that unity, in order to see that the values that that have been part of the Western culture are not compromised. So, and every single half a year, when we see that unfortunately the situation is not improving, not in Ukraine crisis, in the crisis when the Russian is occupying and attacking Ukraine. It's not the Ukraine crisis. We do not have the civil war. We do not have civil conflict on the territory of Ukraine. We do have aggression of one state against another one. So it would not mean so much for each and one of us to make so much effort in order to make sure that sanctions are being rolled over. I do remember a conversation with Mr. Fried back in March, I believe, and we did talk about sanctions and this year. And the feeling was, okay, maybe the sanctions will be rolled over, even though yes, they are violating everything. Yes, they are not delivering on their side. Maybe the EU will be able to roll over sanctions in June. But definitely, this is going to be the last time. Obviously, from the Ukrainian side, it doesn't seem fair. And we are being told that it's not about fairness, that it's not about the law. This is not about those things that we believe in, because we thought that this soft power of the EU, soft power of the Western civilization is so appealing. And I think that we Ukrainians, we Georgians, we Moldovans are right now are more inclined to defend those values than those who have been practicing them for a long time. So we are ready to remind, we are ready to help to defend those, and we hope that that will be enough alarm bell for everybody else to also wake up and get that shot of espresso coffee that you were suggesting at the beginning of this conversation.
Thank you very much. And I must say that it should be broadcasted everywhere, in every capital, I would say, at the newsstand, because it is exactly the message that is undeliverable. I mean that many of the leaders, and I will refer to General Breedlove, who said today in the morning, that what concerns him is the fact that there will be lack of solidarity. If we can't recognize the crisis that is created by or originates in Russia, and we are right now talking about releasing the sanctions, so what's the limit? President Ilves, it's great to have you with us. Hello. Great to have you in Warsaw. We are very happy that you successfully reached our beautiful capital. President, as a free man, as a civilian, you can speak whatever you want. And you are famous for your very outspoken comments, and that's why we really love you. And it's about my wife, she's more saying it, and I'm just, you know, echoing. But what's your opinion about the state of liberal order that we are so proud of? Is it still something we really stand for, or is it just a few slogans that our politicians like to say to focus on what they really want to do?
Well, I'm not so sure it's something politicians use as a slogan, since we know at least one member of the European Union whose prime minister said that liberal democracy is not necessarily the way to go. Leaving that uncommented, but that is a statement that we know of, that I would say even not the politicians even are not particularly willing to defend those values. I see several problems. On the one hand, it is that there is what Christopher Walker of the National Endowment of Democracies has said, a rollback of the Enlightenment. When we talk about liberal democracy, it's not just, it clearly includes freedom of speech, freedom of association, freedom of religion, but it actually is based upon something that originally comes from John Locke and Montesquieu, division of powers, free and fair elections, yes, but even more than that, that an independent judiciary. Without those minimal elements, it's very hard to have liberal democracy. And what Walker talks about is that there is a concerted rollback against this, that, to eliminate the separation of church and state, singling out certain groups to have fewer rights than others. And what I see is an unwillingness on the politicians to actually defend those issues, defend those values. So on the one hand, you have massive disinformatia directed against the West. Europe is called Gay Europa in the Russian media. Free and fair elections are viewed as some kind of bizarre whatever, I don't know, some kind of aberration. I think we are in trouble, and I think that the rise of the populist right and the populist West, I mean the hard right, I'm not talking about CDU or SPD, I'm talking about, you know, the Linke asking Putin to come and help, I'm talking about, you know, Allianz für Deutschland also asking Putin to come and help. I think that the rise of extremism is and the acceptance of extremism, the popularity of extremist positions, is at the same time forcing centrist politicians to move more to the left and more to the right. And all of that, I think, is undermining the liberal democratic order as we have seen it in some countries for 250 years. other places, less so, for a shorter time, either imposed by General Lucian Clay or actually voluntarily, originally opted for in the period of 1989 to 91, when 75 million people in Eastern Europe, all of whom are now members of the European Union, basically opted for liberal democratic values. So I think we are in trouble. And I worry sometimes about, I worry a lot about the direction that we're headed in. I'm also genuinely concerned about the people who benefited from the courage of people like Lech Walesa or Václav Havel or Adam Michnik or Bronislav Geremek. Their followers, I mean the people in the next generation, are not willing to defend the Havels of today or the Walesas of today. I mean, it's kind of like, well, we got in, now we're okay, and to hell with the rest. And we see this that kind of behavior within the European Union mirrored in the behavior of members of NATO, who all think, oh wow, now we have Article 5, this is great, and at the same time contribute almost nothing to, or relatively little, to the defense of the alliance. So I would say, to put it sum up, we're all coasting and not making any effort.
Thank you very much, President. You are the elite. You are the leaders to follow. You are the leaders to be inspiration. And you know your colleagues who are not. And we have examples, including, sorry to refer to you as, we have examples during our political campaigns, presidential campaigns, leaders that we don't want to admire, that in my opinion, I wouldn't like to give as an example to my children. And what shaped you that you were able, or your colleagues that you admire, that made you that without a compromise, you defend the system of the values that is important for you, and why others are giving it up so easily? Why they don't defend it? Why, when we have an example of this famous quote, I think it was Roosevelt, that those who will give out some of their liberties for short-term security in the end will have no freedom and no security. Why people are ready to give out their freedoms and why they follow the leaders that, in my opinion, they don't deserve to be leaders. Maybe they were incubated in too good environment that they haven't had to struggle for their leadership position that they were given maybe too easily. But why we have right now at the many leadership position in our societies, in our countries, people who maybe should never be there. You would like to?
Ladies and friends, gentlemen and friends, human nature is human nature. It was as it was quite a long time ago when our species evolved, and it is the same today. A few days ago, we had a group of young journalists from the Bosch Foundation in Riga, and one young lady from Poland said that, what did I think of the statement that the Poles have become more selfish? Having, and I think President Ilves indirectly alluded to the sort of thing that having achieved their own goals and aspirations, they really do not care much about those of others. And I told her, my dear girl, you must realize that the Poles are human like everybody else in Europe, and they cannot possibly be more selfish than anybody else. It is just the matter of what is accepted in society as the norm, or if you like, the threshold of selfishness that is considered to be politically correct or socially acceptable. And that is the whole issue. Our values are consensual values, if they're liberal ones. They are not necessarily imposed by force, although we do have laws, and we know that we need laws because we have crime, and we have international crime, and we have very serious crime. And anybody who's been in high positions of responsibility, or a president who has an authority to pardon criminals and looks at it twice before reducing somebody's sentence, will realize that crime is something that you cannot tolerate in society. There are limits to what one can tolerate. The question is, how far from the liberal ideals are populations ready to go? And I'm afraid that they are as far ready to go as the promises that politicians will make to them. And just like young girls get seduced by young men who make promises to them to love them eternally, and that they are the most beautiful girl in the world and that they will be faithful to them forever, well, so do citizens get seduced by politicians who tell them that I am the one who will look after you. All these other jokers, you see, just... You see what kind of parlous state they have brought the country in. Everything is terrible. Everything is bad. The sky is falling down. Things are getting worse every day. I will fix it. I mean, that, does it remind you of somebody that you've heard about recently? I will fix it for you. I will get it all done. How? They haven't got a clue. They haven't even got an idea what the problem is. But unfortunately, too many among the population do not have enough upbringing in terms of critical thinking, in terms of rational thinking. And let's face it, as somebody who taught scientific method for much of my academic career, I realized that the scientific method and rational thinking are counterintuitive. And most citizens work on their emotions and their intuition. And this is why bad politicians are a menace, because it's easier to be a bad politician and to have with an emotional campaign that will promise the sky, just like it's easier to seduce a girl if you tell her she's the absolute ultimate and you will love her forever. And people fall into the same trap again and again. And it's a bit of a struggle for those who want to rely on people's critical thinking, rational evaluation of situations, issues. What a boring thing, issues. You see, you look at somebody, you look at their hairdo, at their profile, at the tone of their voice, whether you like them or not, and so on and so forth. Alas, we're all human.
Thank you, madam. I don't know how it happened, maybe subconsciously, because I was thinking a lot about Trump in this reference, and you started talking about seducing a woman and populism and so on. Probably coincident. You would like to refer to those leaders that we have around Berlusconization, Trumpization of our leadership in the liberal order? Before I will yield the floor to our wonderful public,
You forgot.
The names you have just remembered are exactly the kind of people who will openly, the parallel that I have made, if you like, metaphorically, they will literally put the two together.
You forgot a term that perhaps has more Slavic roots, but there's, I think, far more important is Schröderisation.
I agree. Someone said that corruption became, there was weaponization of corruption, and it became a new communism. Interesting, worth thinking about it. This is from another session we had, but I would like to give the floor to General.
Normally, a U.S. military man doesn't get into political discussions, but even that trend has gone the way of of tradition in the U.S. But objectively, and I'll speak from my personal opinion from a U.S. perspective on this question, which I think is a very good one. In the United States, I think it's fair to say that the public has generally lost faith and confidence in the elected bodies. The Congress of the United States has at best a 9% approval rating in the public. And despite this, in their own elections in the Congress of the leadership, they reelect the same leaders that got them to that 9% rating. And so there's a disassociation that's palpable in the electorate that what they think is important and what matters to them is no longer the primary source of concern of the political elite. The media, I think, contributes greatly to that circus-like atmosphere by creating almost a game show atmosphere where candidates from different parties are absolutely unwilling or incapable or both of finding common ground. It is in our political discussion now, if one side is for it, the universal other side is against it. And this is true of national security issues. It's true of foreign policy. These are two areas where in our history, our modern history, the bipartisan nature of those discussions was the primary thing that allowed us to move forward and solve some very serious problems in the world. And as a consequence, again, in my country, I believe that the attractiveness of public service has to people who would otherwise present themselves as candidates because of what they have to go through with the media screening. Not that they're bad people, but it's so penetrating into our lives, and that you don't wish that on your wife, your children, your mother, your father, your friends. It is not a respectful process, and therefore it is a process that I think that is in decline. And so we have to find our way through that, and people say, well, we will, we always do. But in the world and the challenges that we're facing globally and among friends and allies demands that we have leaders that are looked upon by the publics, by our respective publics, as people we admire. And it's not enough to simply win an election by one percentage point and act like you have a mandate. And in my country, the last two administrations have behaved that way. 51% is not a mandate. You win, but that means half the people that voted against you. And you have to be the leader of all people, and you have to be able to make those accommodations. And neither party that I've watched very closely now for 16 years has shown a capacity to do that, and that's to our great collective detriment.
Thank you very much. President Ilves?
Yeah. I just want to say that I think it's not a recent phenomenon. I think it is a gradual decline. When we started seeing the migration crisis, and as a child of refugees, I I looked at what the response was after World War II. In Germany alone, there were 24 million displaced persons, of which 12 million were refugees from outside Germany. And this was in similar proportions repeated across Europe. The response was UNRWA, the United Nations Refugee Relief Agency. If you take the amount of money put into that UNRWA distributed and convert 1945 dollars to 2015 euros, it's 50 billion euros, 50 billion. If we look at the numbers we are talking about today in terms of what are we doing for the refugees, we're haggling over 3 billion euros. And the amount of money, I recall, I think Austria got 1.5 billion euros of today's money, and Italy got about 4, Poland got 3. I mean, this is all huge amounts of money to deal with the refugee crisis. And that was all paid by the UK, Canada, and the United States, none of whom were affected by the refugee crisis themselves. But there was an understanding that for the sake of the security of liberal democracies right after World War II, we need to pony up. Today, here we are in a Europe that is beset by a security crisis that affects ourselves, and we're not willing to do much. But this is not just today. You know, with all of the post-1989-91 Fukuyaman triumphalism, I also recall discussions in the 1980s saying, oh, the Poles shouldn't rock the boat. You know, what is Waleza doing there? I remember discussions from our northern and western neighbors urging us not to rock the boat. I mean, directly, as we had a massive popular movement for independence. I remember certain German officials telling me when I was ready for Europe, tell those people not to rock the boat. So this, you know, what is important is one's own well-being, and you don't really want to shake things up. And I see this now repeated with Ukraine most obviously. We see a country that's invaded, has part of it occupied. It took a year for the European Union even to go beyond the expression of extremely concerned. It took about that long to go beyond the rhetoric of Russian-backed separatists. I mean, we're dealing with at least 10,000 trained, armor-equipped Russian troops. But we don't want to say that, because we don't want to rock the boat. Well, I just keep thinking of Reverend Martin Niemöller's poem when I see that. Thank you.
Thank you, President. When you mention about a boat, I think that we have in our Western community many boats with wonderful sailors, but we are lacking good captains over there. Prime Minister, yes, of course, please.
Just a few words. I really think that this populistic tendency is something that is overwhelmingly getting trendy all over Europe, all in the US, also in our part of Europe as such. And that is something that President Vicky Freiberger was referring to, that it's so easy. It's so appealing to be liked. It's much more difficult to talk deeper than slogans. It's much more difficult to go into substance and discuss with the society substance-wise issues. It's much easier to build on stereotypes as to suggest new notions and to try to plant them, to grow them as in the society. And it seems that everybody, because of the years of decades of growth, of well-being, of actually working norms and principles of the rule of law, of democracy, of participatory democracy. Everybody got relaxed that it doesn't need any additional effort to be polished. It doesn't need any additional effort to become even better system. And now all of these systems at the same time, both security-wise, both democracy-wise, are being challenged at the same time. And the system that was built is not ready to react to too many challenges simultaneously. And just to one more phenomenon that is also very common, and I was always wondering what is wrong with us as Ukrainians, that we have very short memory of those politicians that have been in power, have done wrong, and then we re-elect them. But I hear that it's a totally usual practice in such a developed democracy as the US, so it's nothing phenomenal for Ukraine, unfortunately.
Well, thank you for those conclusions. I would like to yield the floor to the questions. Roland, and then I see our guest from Canada, and I've seen also Jason. So if I could ask for microphone.
Thank you, Zbigniew. I'm Roland Freudenstein from the Wilfried Machtens Center for European Studies, which is the think tank of the European People's Party. And I would like to refer to something that has become very fashionable in recent months, over summer, I would say, to make the case for dividing political debates into open versus closed. So, you know, left and right, maybe categories that that were good for the 20th century, but from now on it is drawbridge uppers versus drawbridge downers, as The Economist called it. Now, I would like to have some of you answer the question, how useful is that concept, really? I mean, I see two basic problems with it. One is, you know, and I do speak for the big political party families in Europe, both the center-left and the center-right, the EPP, would neatly straddle, I think, the divide between open and closed, if you look at their composition at the moment. The other one is that you actually do give the populace the opportunity to say, you know, if you follow The Economist's advice and all the drawbridge downers, the liberals, get together and make their case much more determinedly and actively, you do give the populace the opportunity to say, ah, see, that's the elite. They're all together, they all have the same interests, and that is the real polarization. I'm afraid if you use that neat divide, open versus closed, you will never get majorities in elections.
Thank you. Thank you for your voice. And
Hi, Basma Omani, professor at the University of Waterloo and fellow at Brookings and CG. I'm wondering how much of this not rocking the boat and this overall silence is really about EU's dependence on Russian oil, and if someone can comment on that. The second thing is, are we really talking about the end of liberalism, or are we talking about challenges to authority? You know, there's so much written today about power is being eroded. Power is no longer in the hands of, whether it's in the boardroom, whether it's in the parliament, it's clearly being eroded today, challenged whether you believe in its social media or the excessive amount of information. But is there a relationship problem between leaders and the people? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I would like to collect all the questions that we have for today, because we have very limited time. We have like 6 minutes. So Marcin Burzański and Jason Warlich.
Thanks very much. Is it working? Yes. Thanks very much, Zbyszek, and thank you to all the panelists for your excellent presentations. President Ilves, reflecting on what you mentioned about the scale of the response needed, I think we can refer to the time of the Marshall Plan, and I think it's a very, very important point. What I would like to ask all of you as leaders and politicians is, how do you sell this urgency to the constituencies, especially when we're facing the trends when big sacrifices are not popular, on the contrary? So what political strategy would you devise for that?
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Jason?
Thank you. Jason Moorlidge from the Community Democracies. Maybe tying into this question a little bit, how real is the trend of the willingness of populations to sacrifice these values of liberalism in exchange for security? And if this is an actual trend, what do you suggest to policymakers? What do you suggest to actually roll back this rollback? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think for now, it must be sufficient. If I could ask you to refer to those questions or share your comments or thoughts about the future of our the world we live in, President Freiberg.
We have heard reference already today to economic conditions and their link to political opinion. In the post-World War, Second World War, that is, world of Europe, one part of it saw increasing economic growth and the other saw increasing consolidation of an authoritarian regime. And after all, several generations grew up under it. And many aspects of an authoritarian regime became just part of their everyday life, and there's certain aspects of it that they find attractive. And I think there we have to recognize that some things, maybe like having kindergartens available for free to everybody, is not a bad idea, unless you force everybody to put their children in there, you see, which makes a bit of a difference. The ability to choose, I think, is what is really at issue. People are feeling after the crisis of 2007 and 8, the economic crisis, that their economic conditions are diminishing their ability to choose or influence events. I think that when somebody sees their pension fund evaporating into something that some trader was bandying about and turns out to be an empty package that's being bounced like a football from one financial institution to another, and at the end of it, they've opened up the package and there's nothing for my old age after I've been paying in my pension fund all my life. Well, that does not make you very happy, and it shouldn't either. When you look at the Gini indexes, indices across the world, the United States, for all its growth and achievements, has an alarming trend of an increasing divide between the top of the population that owns most of the wealth and the bottom of the population that has not the minimum. And in fact, Europe is in many ways experiencing the same phenomenon. We're seeing the same phenomenon in China. Huge numbers have been lifted out of poverty, but huge numbers still remain in it. Or you have the super excessive, obscenely rich, and others who do not have the essential minimum that makes for dignified human existence. Those inequities, I think, are one of the factors. I'm not saying the only one, but a hugely important factor. And globalization and the financial international financial system, I think, has a big responsibility. And yes, the media too, they make a circus of things because they like to entertain us. And if we accept to be entertained in such a cheap way, then we better watch out for the results. Because yes, the media is the message, and the media is also, I think, the culprit here for many things.
Thank you very much. President, some remarks?
Okay. Well, first of all, on populations being willing or not, ultimately, I think it requires leadership. And when you have, it just strikes me as bizarre that, you know, hundreds of thousands of people fled Hungary 60 years this month, and they were taken care of. I find it bizarre that they say, oh, no, now with someone's fleeing. I mean, I see that, you know, hundreds of thousands of Czechs. I mean, they're known as the 68 generation because there was a wave in 48, then there's a wave in 68. And now it's like, no, we won't take anyone. the broader phenomenon, I think that we do not have a sense of solidarity. I mean, I may be off on by five or so points, but I remember reading this poll that Germany, 89% people think that NATO should help them if attacked, and something over 50% should defend Western Europe if attacked, but 29% thought, well, if you know NATO members to our east are attacked, then we should go help them. I mean, I'm not sure what's behind that, but in any case, it's pretty funny. And as it's not so funny. And we're NATO members. The result of not being a NATO member, I mean, where there are even no treaty obligations, we see today in Ukraine. We saw it in 2008 in Georgia, where 1 month after Nicolas Sarkozy negotiated a deal that would require as a prerequisite the removal of Russian troops, at the next European Council in September in Paris, he said, thank God common sense prevailed that we didn't do anything to Russia and in fact signed a new modernization program agreement. So we don't have much in the way of solidarity, and it's especially odd to see some countries claim solidarity when in fact they exhibit none in other realms. On the issue of how much oil plays a role, well, the role of oil, the percentage of Russian oil and gas has decreased dramatically, and even more dramatically, the price of it. And at this time, when we have overstocks in oil, I think it's much more a fear of change, just as fear of any kind of change in the, the Finns and Swedes who said to Estonia, don't rock the boat in 1990-91, I don't think they were worried about oil. I think they just didn't want the ways of doing things to change. So I don't think it's that strictly economic in that sense. One more statistic, which I should just mention because I think we should all know it. I did the statistics myself, but what do I know? But now it's been done by serious economists and published by Anders Rasmussen's think tank. But the countries that have suffered the most from sanctions in terms of percentage of GDP have been Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, and Poland. Those are the countries that have suffered the most. The countries that are most opposed to ending sanctions happen to be Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, and Poland. The countries that want to eliminate sanctions are countries for which the actual impact is minimal. This again speaks to the point of solidarity, self-interest. I don't know what it says about self-interest, but it certainly seems that some countries remember absence of freedom more than other countries. And I should just also say that if we're looking at genuine sort of adherence and belief in liberal democracy, it's Kazimierz Pulaski. I mean, I didn't know much about him except for this terrible highway called the Pulaski Skyway that goes from Newark to the Hudson River. And if you've ever been on it, it's one of the worst in the world. Later on, I discovered who Kazimierz Pulaski was. And if you think about someone, volunteering to go to defend liberty abroad, that should be the example for all of us.
In the last proclamation of Pulaski Day in U.S., President Obama reminded that he saved the life of George Washington. So that's who he was. Okay, General and Prime Minister, just the final remarks and in reference to the questions or the subject.
Well, thank you. as I was listening to the great comments by the panel and the great questions, I was thinking about the traditional idea of leadership and thinking about the leaders, at least in my lifetime, that have made a difference in the world. And it seems to me that that this isn't so much the end of liberalism, but there is definitely a challenge to authority. And it could be that the authority that's being challenged, you know, because of the exposure that is available in the social media and all sorts of inquests that go on and say seemingly at the drop of a hat, has a very discouraging effect to people who might otherwise want to present themselves for elected office. But it's clear that leadership is not a dying art. But there's an absence of effective leadership where our collective interests are concerned. And I hope that in the next administration, that the United States will regain its footing and will rededicate itself to the idea of not only what it's willing to do, but defending the real core values around the concepts of democracy and freedom. It doesn't mean that we have to go completely crazy and have an absence of order. In effect, from 1945 on, we've had a world that was dangerous, but was ordered. We had institutions that were able to handle the difficult times and ways in which we talked to one another through the United Nations, through the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, and then the EU and others. And it seems to me that in this 21st century, with the multiplicity of threats that we face, cybersecurity, economic security, food and water, if you look at the demographics of and the potential migrations that still face us, and Europe in particular, coming from the south in the not too distant future, these are things that we have to coalesce around. You can't pretend like it's not going to happen, and you can't bury your head in the sand and say, well, maybe it won't happen here. We are all vested in this. We all bought into it in the 20th century, and we need to make the adjustments necessary, and we need to encourage the next generation of leaders to present themselves and to support them and to present themselves in a way that demonstrates courage, vision, and dedication to the values that all of us, I think, in this room hold to be very, very dear.
Thank you, General, for this important word.
Well, thank you. In 1991, we also had American leader coming to Ukraine and suggesting that we should not actually rock the boat, and Ukraine's independence is not something that will come through. And I think that I agree that did not come at that point definitely from any serious dependence on the Russian gas or oil. But that came somehow from our common, I think, lack of ability to foresee things and to accept the reality and accept that maybe something that we are used to is not going to be present for the nearest, 15 years. And this is, I think, something that is also happening right now. Those with the more national historic experience, with their own personal experience, they are more inclined to challenge the easiness of the process, so to say. They are more inclined to try to see different scenarios and try to look for different solutions, as opposed to just relax and continue business as usual, or seek continuing business as usual. And absolutely, something that we are really lacking all over, not only Europe, but much wider, the lack of the
of enough of those leaders that would be able and ready to trade percentage of their popular support for taking a stance, taking a very clear stance. And we see this in different countries that people are rather, or those elected leaders are rather more inclined to look for support of the populace, and not really thinking that maybe this couple of percent that you're going to lose in the next elections, maybe they will save actually your country in a decade or so, and you'd rather sit back and maybe not be there today, but because you lost. But you actually did something that made sure that your country is much better off in the future. With regard also to information, it's not only about media playing the whole, or serving the whole, not that much the variety of opinion, but the speed of the information, but the scandalous type of information that is much easier getting through to the first pages of any media outlet in the whole world, as opposed to information that is much deeper, that is not necessarily that emotionally immediately appealing. And that's again because we are accepting information much faster right now. We are exposed to much more information. We have to be somehow out, and our attention has to be somehow dragged to this information. So that's why it's much easier with this more difficult more easy scenes, so to say. And I want to refer to one more thing at the as a last comment. We are talking about participatory democracy. We are talking about liberal order. But sometimes we are taking it to the extreme. That is then basically ruining the whole idea of this liberal order. And I'm referring right now to the referendum in the Netherlands, which had to be a recommendatory character, that had to suggest whether association agreement with Ukraine could or should or not or could not be ratified by the Netherlands in order to be taken as a legitimate referendum. 30% of population had to come to the polling stations. 32% come out of those 60 voted no, not really understanding what association agreement is, what it means for Ukrainian people, how it was fought for, nothing of that type, which means that right now 0.6% of the population of the European Union is taking hostage the country that is still fighting for democracy, still fighting for transformation, and still fighting for those values that just recently have been also common for the Dutch people. So there, I think that is taking it to the totally extreme and nonsense point. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prime Minister. Sorry, we have really no time. If I can conclude in one sentence, if in this very region of Europe or the world, in my opinion, liberal order has a name, it's Ukraine, and how we'll behave, it will define who we are or who we want to be. Thank you very much, and I hope that you will join me in thanking those wonderful guests.